Takeovers of mosques in Mombasa to massacres such as happened in Mandera this weekend. Religion is becoming a very toxic matter together with terrorism in this country. This morning we want to take a look at exactly what is the link and are people hiding behind religion to commit crime. Our guest is former Speaker Farah Maalim. Karibu.
Thank you.
Maalim, you are vast in these things. Let's look at, first of all, the state of insecurity that seems to be cutting across from northern Kenya, Turkana, going to coasts, and now into the horn of the country bordering Somalia. What is your logical explanation of what is happening for people who may want to know?
I think there's need for us to really reassess the role of our own security managers. I think we have a serious problem with the delivery of services by the security managers. We need to get the right people for the right jobs. We are under attack, serious attack from terrorists. I mean, this is a phenomenon we have lived with for a couple of years now. At the same time, we have internal cracks, serious internal cracks between the different communities. And because of the fact that we are operationalizing a new dispensation in this country in the form of the new constitution, which has created the provisions for the county governments, there's definitely going to be a lot of inter-county, intra-county activities that will happen. I mean, people are trying to jostle for resources. People are trying to jostle for relevance, both the political leadership of all those counties as well as the communities themselves. The issue of natural resources is there. The issue of poverty is there. So with all those new dynamics,
yeah,
it's important for us to have a very effective and efficient.
It looks like, I mean, this matter is getting, as you mentioned, all,
yeah,
those dimensions,
yes,
making this really an explosive,
absolutely,
mix.
Absolutely.
In terms of strategy, do we see our government or state agencies' response being equal to the challenge or the threat?
No, absolutely not. Absolutely not.
Where are the gaps in your view?
Well, the gaps are in
both the leadership,
yes,
and,
yes,
in security measures.
The most important thing,
provisions.
Yeah, the most important thing is the leadership of those security agencies. You see, even the security agencies, the challenge we have right now is that this is not the security agencies that we're used to in pre-2010 constitutional dispensation.
Mm.
In the pre-2010, pre-2009, before, we used to have a special branch. The special branch was an arm of the police service. They basically gathered the intelligence, and they were on the ground. And it used to do quite a good job those days. Right now, we have an intelligence service that is a civilian force that is, by and large, what you'd call fat cats, people who get paid very well and who do very little for this country in terms of intelligence gathering. I'm hoping the new leadership of the security intelligence itself will bring in very much-needed reforms in there, and maybe it's going to function better than it did before. Because it's coming from an active service, it's coming from the military.
But is it a failure of intelligence gathering, or is it a failure of response? Because
it's
both. Those arguments have been on the table for a long time.
Yeah,
the intelligence presents the information.
It's both.
If you look at the recent attacks, for example, the Mandera one.
Yeah,
there is evidence that information was abroad, was,
yeah,
out here.
Yeah,
and that,
yeah,
you know, it is the use of that intelligence that failed to,
yeah,
preempt
but
the,
see,
attack.
Yeah, because Mandera is a boundary.
Yeah.
And we have just across the border Al-Shabaab there, and we are at war with Al-Shabaab. The maintenance of law and order, the maintenance of peace in that place and stability in that place does not fall entirely on the police alone.
Yeah.
The military has a role in there.
Yes.
The military is the one which is supposed to flush out Al-Shabaab from all our borders. The police cannot go across border. So it's also powerfully a failure on the part of the military. because even in the military, it's the wrong people doing the wrong jobs. You see what I mean? I mean, we don't have the kind of leadership that we needed in the military itself.
Military.
You know, I'll tell you.
You know, I mean, someone listening to Farah will say this is a man who will just complain, not agree, or not appreciate anything that, you know, there's no leadership across all.
I tend to agree with him because look at it this way. I've seen in today's newspaper a fellow described as a police reservist at guarding the border. Surely a police reservist at the border in Madeira today, what would he do?
Well, the border.
Those Al-Shabaab fellows who killed the people in the bus.
Yes.
Are they the same equipment like the
G3 is holding?
Yeah.
What will it help? Absolutely.
The trouble is that the border is pretty a long stretch of land.
What is KDF
you
doing in Smayu, selling charcoal?
Be able
why
to
are they not at the border?
All elements, and then communities
isn't
have
it?
To have
isn't
internal
that
look.
Security arrangements, right?
David,
how do you fuse these local arrangements with the national apparatus or the response mechanism such as KDF, which has got, you know, camps all over the place?
No. You see, KDF, we have a very elaborate and a very long airstrip in Wajir, which was actually put in there in the late 70s and the early 80s after the Ogaden War, after the Ethiopia-Somalia War.
Yes.
That in the event that we become under attack, we have to have this rapid response. We have the helicopter gunships. For example, immediately as a follow-up, I heard the deputy president say that we sent our forces in there. Those are not ground forces. What was sent in there is the helicopter gunships.
Yeah.
And the helicopter gunships already know the bases and the locations of Al-Shabaab inside Somalia across the border. Why do they wait until what has happened now has
That's
happened?
That's the whole point.
For
That's
them,
why it's
for
not
them
even
to take
easy
them out.
To agree or
absolutely.
Believe them.
Why
absolutely.
Were they there?
Why
absolutely.
Were they there? Why
don't
did
we have a buffer?
Them?
Absolutely.
Why don't we have a buffer?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Why do we go all the way to Kismayu when right at our border here,
there
is a possibility for us? By the way, let me tell you one thing. That's why I tell you sometimes the issue of Al-Shabaab seems to be serving certain political interests in this country, and it's like we don't want to get rid of its entirety.
And, well, that's a very controversial statement.
Of course, it's a very controversial.
Yes,
I've said it before.
They call you to record a statement because they wanted.
Absolutely.
They didn't believe that.
And
yes.
Now is when Kenyans are asking if we are able to follow these people in hot pursuit and destroy their bases and everything. It's not a forest there, by the way. It's a very open expanse. It's something that our own surveillance is able to pick out.
Mm-hmm.
These guys have a ragtag presence all across the border, Mandera, all the way to Wajir, and across the border on the other side. They don't come to Gariza because Gariza is the Ras Kamboni presence,
yes.
Which is, by the way, the Ras Kamboni wanted to go and flush them out and clean them out of our borders. The Kenya military told them, no, we will only move in when we give you the go-ahead and the green light.
Mm.
So why are we going all the way to Kismayu, selling charcoal there and taking money from the port there? When we are supposed to be doing such a good job just across our border. The governor of Mandera has been sounding this a lot and saying there's a problem. There's only one day. In one day, there were how many explosions in Mandera itself?
Even he survived as an attack.
He survived himself as an attack.
Yes.
What did the government do to deal with that?
Yeah.
You see, we can take out Burhaji. We can take out Al-Shabaab in Elberde. Sorry, not Elberde. It's called Bardere.
Mm.
We can take them out in a place called Buale, Saku. You know, all these are places where there are, you know, 50 of them, 100 of them, with hardly any military equipment to match our armed forces. You send a couple of helicopters there and you send them running skelter-helter like rats for their lives. They don't have the capacity. But we don't have the goodwill to get rid of them.
Why? Why? I mean, what does
my
it
question?
Sound?
I want you to ask the same question that I've been asking. The same question that I've been asking myself. We can only speculate. We can only look at, you know, because we can do the job and we're not doing the job. And in the process, Kenyans are losing their lives.
And you can't put this to sheer incompetence or our forces
absolutely,
to wipe them
absolutely
out. You
not.
Don't think
absolutely.
It's just mere capacity,
no.
inability
no.
of our forces.
What would the government benefit?
I don't know. Your guess is as good as mine. I mean, I want everybody to think loud about it.
Okay, let's look at Mandera.
We had all those explosions in Isli last time. You remember, yes. We had all this series of explosions, which are almost on a daily basis. By the way, whatever Al-Shabaab does, Al-Shabaab claims responsibility.
Yes.
Anytime they do something, they claim responsibility. Anytime they don't claim responsibility, invariably, 9 out of 10 or 10 out of 10, they are not responsible for it.
Now,
and that's why all those things that are happening in Isli, they never claim responsibility for that. That's why I doubted who is the person doing this and how, why does it suddenly stop? Is it because of putting people in Kasarani and the rest of it?
Yeah, is that not the reason?
No,
when they did
They
did a swoop.
Look,
there's never been any since then.
The only thing that the swoop may be assisted in is in creating many more young men who are taken back there to join Al-Shabaab. You get my point? And if they seriously wanted to do it, they would, and they were responsible for it, we'd be seeing, you know, so many of it here. Yeah. That's why my assumption is that it's somebody else who was doing it and not them.
Now,
who was doing it, your guess is as good as mine.
Farah, let's get very basic here. Let's go ethnic.
Yeah.
You are Somali.
Yes.
There is argument that, for example, in dealing with insecurity in some of these parts of northern Kenya, like Wajir Mandera, the clanism, you know, the divisions between clans within the Somali tribe affect the ability of the security forces to eradicate criminals from within, because either they're hidden or they collude.
Can I tell you something that you need to know about these things? As far as Al-Shabaab is concerned, the Somalis of Kenya, the Somalis of Somalia, the proper citizens, are 100%, 99.99% united. There is issues, there could be issues, certain dynamics between two clans, like the Garri and the Degodia, which was there some time back. There are all those issues. And Al-Shabaab never gets involved in these things, by the way. Mm. They never get involved in inter-clan, intra-clan conflicts.
Yeah.
As far as Al-Shabaab is concerned, which has its own ideology, all Kenyan Somalis are in unison, opposed to it. All Somalis, except these guys are holding everybody else in Somalia hostage. That's why when our forces went to Jubaland and we went through this corridor all the way to Kismayu, all the local people, the residents, they're the ones who are giving the information, they were the ones who are helping, they were the ones who are even volunteering militias.
Yes.
All we need to do is just take positive actions for us to get rid of them across our border all the way from Mandera to Wajir. And a little bit past, closer to Gariza, because that corridor of Gariza all the way south, they've been flushed out.
Yeah.
And to flush them out does not need so much equipment. It doesn't need so many much manpower. These guys are running around with few technicals and with you know, guns and a few shoulder head things.
Mm.
With our helicopter gunships, we can literally pick them out the way we want.
Mm.
And that's why you see in this follow-up, this hot pursuit which was done now. I want to believe what the deputy president said.
A lot of people don't.
A lot. Well, I
don't believe it myself.
I seriously, if the helicopter gunships were sent in there, they're able to do. And we have all the information, by the way. We have all the intelligence information, because we have these drones, and the Americans share this intelligence information with us. We also have our own drones these days, you know that, which are operated, and they're able to gather this information.
Yeah.
And it's not a forest. That land is not a forest. It's an arid and semi-arid area, so you're able to pick out anything
but
from
when,
the sky.
When are we going to get, you know, of course this is a war situation, but aren't we able to encircle, to at least get some casualties that we can hold and present? I mean, even we see Al-Shabaab sometimes capture, you know, our troops, so when they raid, they go with some people. How come we are not able to capture some attackers or raiders or Al-Shabaab and present and say, look, now these are the guys we've caught, and they're going to lead us to get to the root of this problem? I mean, that is why every time the government announces it has, you know,
now
operated
you
and killed,
it
looks like fiction.
You are a very ordinary citizen, and you with no security training and very little security exposure, and you're able to pick out such basic things. You understand my point?
Mm.
You're able to see these lapses and flaws in the rest of it. That is why we're worried that our government is not sincere about the war on terrorism. That we moved in there for other
because
purposes.
For example, to come up with a figure
other
of 100,
yes.
You know, 100 is a figure,
and
it's a body count.
And you're not bringing bodies there.
And there are no bodies,
yes.
Not even on display.
Yes, yes.
I mean, for whatever reasons there can
even
be, you can say that may inflame more terrorism.
Anyway.
But there has to be some you know, concrete evidence of a successful operation.
Well, I just hope they did not kill some innocent Camel herders out there. But I also believe very strongly that the air cavalry we have right now here, those boys,
they're good.
They're very good.
Yeah.
They're exceptionally good. You only need to send some two helicopters out there and they will flash them out like hell. And they will destroy their bases. You know, with 2 days operations out there,
yeah,
we can get rid of the entire Al-Shabaab from the entire that axis, that zone. But why don't you want to get rid of them? Your guess is as good as mine.
Anyway, let's go back to what is happening in Mombasa.
Yeah, let's look at the religion.
Mombasa, Mombasa is a bit tricky and clearly straightforward also. There is an element of radicalization, there's no question about that.
Yes.
And the radicalization also was fueled by the lack of our own security machinery to arrest many of those guys who were pushing for that and put them behind bars. And then we went into the same terrorist actions of doing extrajudicial killings, which basically inflames more and more youths also to do what they did. The elements of drugs.
Drugs.
There's a serious drugs problem in Mombasa. There is a restless youth out there who, I don't know who is behind, but definitely either are being manipulated by some errant and very, very destructive clergies. Or you never know, maybe even some drug lords, you never know that. You get my point. And some of those guys, those boys out there, are not people who have such powerful, extreme convictions on religion or the knowledge of religion itself. They have very scanty knowledge of that.
Mm.
It's my sincere hope that now the security machinery has gone into a number of mosques. I don't know the veracity or the truth of what they tell us, that there are a few grenades or arms catches and the rest of it.
They were found inside.
Were found in there. I don't know. I wouldn't see the wisdom of somebody putting in 5 grenades in a mosque, when if they want to hide them, they can hide them in a million other places to hide them. And in any case, why would you use to hide them in the mosque when they know that the police had stormed the mosques before? But be that as it may, we want to see some concrete evidence. And if 250 of them were arrested, they should be able to screen them and get out of them a few of them who can be brought to court and who can be successfully prosecuted and convicted. And then use that intelligence information itself to destroy those cells. You see what I mean?
Yes, yes.
This business that you fire at a concentrated
camp or
what do you call concentrated target,
yes,
and assume and hope that one criminal among some 200 people there is also going to be caught up. Why do you kill the 200 people? Is an outdated, clearly. It's actually a crime.
But in fact, proceedings from after the arrest of 250?
No.
Not much has been heard about whether they've been screened.
Whether they've been taken to court.
And they've been taken to court. Yeah. And so, in fact,
they're
out there. The last we had such an operation, some people disappeared. And
what about that leadership in the mosque?
The leadership,
controversies about
the leadership of the mosques is that some very respectable, responsible clergies who are authorities on the faith itself and the knowledge of the faith have either been killed by these young men or intimidated and scared in hell. For example, Sheikh Mohammed Idris was a man in his own class, an exceptional guy. And he was killed, and the assumption is that he was killed by the youth. I don't know, we don't know who killed him. But the long and the short of it is that we don't have sufficient government action and investigation to establish these things.
But, Farah.
Me and you can only speculate, can only imagine maybe they were killed by so-and-so or killed by so-and-so.
But,
this.
Look, I'm trying to assess the difficulty of doing an investigation and intelligence gathering in a community, a religious community such as the mosque, the Muslims who go to a mosque. By the time there are 250 people in a mosque gathering, can that escape intelligence?
No.
Or can they fail to get information of what is going on there?
No. They should be able to have verbatim.
Exactly.
They should be able, these days again with this age of of
telephony,
telephoning, and all these digital things. You can just have a small, you know, phone, and you literally capture all the evidence verbatim.
Yes,
verbatim. And there are so many Muslim intelligence officers who I don't think are being deployed in these cases here, who can go there and leave their beards, and basically nobody knows them, and can gather all that information, yeah, and can give the right intelligence information to the government and say, look, the problem is those five young men. And the five young men will be picked out from their own houses instead of moving into that, and then pick the rest of the young men and then go for some kind of counseling, you know what I mean? And right now, many elderly clergy, Muslim clergy, who would want to counsel those young men are scared for their own lives.
Exactly.
And again, nobody knows who is paying these guys. Nobody knows who is paying these guys. You know, some of the stuff that you...
Is it? No, Farah. When you go to a mosque, you go to Jamia Mosque, or wherever, or in Nairobi.
Yes.
That community is very well knit. People get to know each other. Yes. Isn't there a brotherhood, you know, fraternity that people can get to know? And can't the leadership, I know the way mosques are organized with committees, can they do their own intelligence and figure out what is cutting within the membership? And share that with the state?
What they did with a few mosques, the entire committee was flushed out. The imams were thrown out by these young men.
Yeah.
And they took over the mosques. These young men took over the mosques. So essentially, it's...
When you say they took over,
yeah,
what that means is that the membership of those who are going there to worship, yeah, all believed in the same
No.
Because
no,
if they didn't, then that's what I'm saying, still the information could come out on what those who took over
you
were
see,
trying to
you do. See, let me tell you, the mosque, the imams, once you take over the imams and the committee, I mean, you have taken over the management of the mosque. Okay. It's like a church.
Yes.
You have the management of the church and you have the congregation.
Yes. How much congregation is different from the man?
Yes, of course. That's the point. So that's exactly what I'm telling you. The people who worship there.
Yes.
When it reaches time for prayers, I mean, I will pray at the nearest mosque myself.
Yes.
And I don't have to find out exactly what kind of a committee is there and how they transact business.
Yes.
This is a holy place. It's a place of where you go and worship, exactly like the way you do in churches.
Yes.
But the fact of the matter is that this is information that should be very readily available to the government. But to the security arms of the government. Today, with my own little knowledge of intelligence and security and the rest of it, if I had the authority right now and the resources to gather that information, I'll just recruit a few.
You get it?
Yeah, it's possible. Recruit the young men, have the resources out there, let them enmesh there, let them pray with those things, let them join the youth and everybody. You get the right information. Then there's a very powerful social problems that needs to be addressed. The reason why it's easily possible for a place like Coast Province right now to recruit young boys into radicalization efforts is because there's so many of them who have not had a chance at making something out of themselves. You see this historical marginalization itself, yeah, which was there.
Hopelessness, despondency,
really despair.
Despair is basically
what's there.
Yeah.
And that needs to be addressed.
Yeah.
And it's something that can easily be addressed. They're not that many. I mean, you can easily address it. And I think the government needs to put together.
But that environment is not unique to the coast.
Well, you see, the coast is fairly unique to the coast because if you go back to where you came from right now, I mean, you find it across. I mean, there are so many young people who are, but you also find so many who are successful and who are in universities and the rest of it. Ask yourself, what's the percentage of students in our public universities right now from the Coast Province and from Mombasa and those areas, Kwale, Mombasa?
That is an urban culture, I think, that has developed there. The concentration is high.
It's, yeah.
The hopelessness, the groups meeting,
it's infectious. It's heavy. It's infectious.
Yeah. So
and you know, because of the certain obvious things. Which go back to history, and we can't cover those things right now. They seem to have been left out from independence until today. And you know, government has got to take a positive, affirmative action to deal with such issues and commit resources to that. I'll give you a simple example. I mean, when I came to Parliament in 1992, we had only 65 students from the entire Somali community, whether they're urban in Nairobi, Kitale, Eldoret, but from Northeastern itself, we had less than 20 in all our public universities here in the country. So you can imagine how many of them, I mean, 1,000, 2,000 young men do their KCSE, And only two of them come to universities here. And the rest of them, they remain behind. You can imagine if that is built over a period of 10 years, 15, 20 years, then what do you have there? Yeah. You have a powder cake. So, but then what happened is that we got a motion in parliament, and we had this affirmative action through quota systems, and the former president, second president Moi, actually directed that it should be implemented. And it was implemented in all institutions of higher learning. That has created a massive difference. And now you hear about people talk of Somalis doing very well in this country. You have to understand this is only a success that was achieved in the last 20 years. No more than the last 20 years. And given an opportunity, young boys and girls in Lamu, in Kwale, in Kilifi, in Malindi, in Tana River, I mean, that can also change. You need very little efforts on the part of the government to completely change. There are not so many. What are they, 100,000? 200,000 young men and women. And the government needs to do that, because that has been done in other parts of the country at independence and subsequent to independence in a big way. Mm. The fact that they did not supply us with any president or any deputy president or powerful people in the system, fortunately for us, we supplied the most respected and renowned chief of general staff in this country through an accident of life when General Mohamed aborted the coup. Mm. And he put his life at risk and defended the constitution. Then, of course, we got integrated by and large to a certain limited extent into
but
the mainstream.
But there's quite a substantial number of Muslims or Somalis who are in the administrative structures of this country. There's no doubt about it. How many people we hear county commissioners or DCs in the previous? In fact, during the Moi regime, there was a lot of Somalis who held positions in the provincial administration.
Yes, yes.
Which was strategic and deliberate.
It was strategic. It's deliberate. They did very well. They served this country better than any other community. They did such a good job, fantastic job. I don't think we've done as much efforts for the coastal Muslims and the coastal Christians also as probably we did for other communities like the Somalis last time. Mm. What needs to be done right now is a very powerful affirmative action to address the issues of the coast. And then the other thing we did is that we took all their jobs. You know what I mean? I mean the hotels and everything, the port. Yeah. You know.
Okay.
Now, it's easy to create that something that they can feed on that radicalization, both at the subnational, you know, as coastal people. That's why they say Pwani si Kenya. By the way, MRCs and all is the cuts across the religions. It's nothing to do with just Islam. What you're seeing, the agitation you're seeing right now within the Muslim youth, there's a similar agitation also with the Christian youths there. That's why MRC is not a religious thing. So that needs to be addressed in a big way, the whole coastal issue.
The radicalization, what is the doctrine that says, you know, let's talk as the Islamic, from an Islamic perspective.
Yes, yes.
Why is religion, what is being exploited in the teachings of Islam that can justify the Al-Shabaab killings, segregating people of different religions, saying you're not a Muslim, you're a target? What is the justification, if at all?
There is absolutely no justification in Islam. It's absolutely, that is not Islam.
Yeah.
That is something else that they themselves have come up with. The fact that certain people, guided by their own existentialist or, you know, political persuasions, can try and dovetail themselves into religion and try and take advantage, because religion, they say, is
opium. It's happening all over the world.
It's happening all over the world.
It's all over the world.
Yes.
Boko Haram.
That's what I'm saying. It's not only unique. Actually, the Muslims, certain extremist Muslim young men using this religion as a conduit for their own political objectives, is probably a phenomena that is new to the Muslims. But for example, in the Christian sense, take a look at Reverend Jim Jones of Guyana. I don't know if you remember that, who went there and created a colony there,
a cult there,
and ended up killing. And then you remember the Waco,
yes.
The Waco thing, David Koresh,
and
everything, including the Dutch Reformed Church, who through the church's teachings and the Bible themselves were able to justify that the white race had to be separated from the black race. and brought in apartheid. Apartheid was hinged, was actually anchored on the Bible itself, according to their own interpretations.
Yes.
So to get somebody who will try and use religious bad is not just unique to Muslims. It happens in all faiths. It happens in Hinduism. Look at these Hindus, you know, these crazy Hindus who have to come to power in India now, who used to destroy mosques and say that this was the house of Ram, God, you know, and also who did awful things to the Christian minorities in India. But that does not say that the whole Hindu community, I mean the Hindu community, Mahatma Gandhi was a Hindu, and Jawaharlal Nehru was a Hindu, and all the Gandhis who were there were Hindus. So basically you will always find somebody who will try and misuse religion. But the level to which is being misused right now in Islam, it shocks all Muslims, all proper Muslims in the world. And that has nothing to do with Islam, by the way. ISIS, in my opinion, and by the way, the bulk of the ISIS members, the leadership of ISIS, are people who converted to Islam from either Judaism, who were Jews before, who were Christians. So you wonder sometimes, the impression we get is that these guys have been infiltrated by the intelligence agencies of those countries themselves to go and make a bad name for Islam and discredit the religion itself. And you never know, because you
that
see...
That is in Iraq.
In Iraq, Syria. in everywhere. Even in Al-Shabaab, up until very recently, there were so many foreign fighters there. And who knows who they were.
In fact, that's what I wanted to ask you about.
This guy who was supposed to be the Al-Qaeda spokesman, media spokesman, Gadan.
Godane.
Adam Gadan. Not Godane.
Gadan. Yes.
Gadan. Gadan was a Jew. And he converted to Islam, supposedly. And this was a guy who was telling the Muslims in America, you can buy guns in every outlet, pick up the guns, and go and kill every non-Muslim you see out there. But he himself was a non-Muslim just a short while before. He doesn't know the religion that well, but he clearly suddenly becomes an authority on Islam and gives Islam this bad name. What I wonder is that, has he actually been a Muslim, or this was, he came in there to create a bad name for Islam itself? Bulk of these guys, real extremist guys, were not born Muslims. These are people who converted the Muslim to Islam and who have a very scanty knowledge of the religion itself.
That leads me to what I want to ask you about what happened in Mandera. It is witnesses say that those people, the killers, were speaking Swahili. The same thing happened to the killers in Paketoni.
Yes.
They identified people.
Yes. Indeed, yes.
Does that mean, therefore, we have a lot of infiltration of Kenyans who have gone to Al-Shabaab?
Oh, yes.
What does it mean?
Oh, yes, undoubtedly. There are very many young men who left the country and joined Al-Shabaab. Very many young men who are from all ethnic communities, by the way, let me tell you. All ethnic communities. And for your information, except the top one or three leadership up there, the entire middle...
In fact, in Paketoni, there was one Kamau.
Yes.
The Muslim name.
Who was literally the manager.
Yes, and who disappeared.
Yes. You see, the entire second tier of leadership in Al-Shabaab, the bulk of them are non-Somalis. The bulk of them are Kenyans, graduates, very well-educated people from our own local universities here, from Tanzania, from as far as Congo, from all these places, who converted to Islam. So it's not an ethnic thing, actually, let me be honest with you. It's not an ethnic thing. And they're the ones who are very, very brutal, I'm told, extremely brutal. And they cut across all the tribes in Kenya. You find Luos, you find Kikuyus, you find Merus, you find literally every community, like Luyas, like Elgiva Bure, yeah.
Yes.
Where it was a Luya. And they're all over. And so basically, one needs to gather sufficient information and intelligence and to see how we can deal with that in a manner that essentially is decisive and brings this to an end. But I want us to support our security machinery and organs. I mean, the way things are right now, we have to support one another to bring this to an end. Mm. We will pick out the way we feel that there are certain lapses and weaknesses that the government needs to strengthen. But it's important the country stays united in the fight against these terrorists and terrorism in this country and insecurity.
Now that you're here and you're from ODM, maybe you should talk about what happened yesterday.
Mm.
That we had an appointment instead of
an election.
An election. What do you think about that?
I thought we had... We had a gentleman's agreement when we had our small chit chat that you not ask me about this, but now
I'm taking one.
I would look very foolish if I don't ask you the question.
man is not an ADM official. He's a ranking member of the party.
He's a member, but influential also. Look, from a deputy speaker.
Yeah.
Yeah, but including, of course, even from a security dimension, what we're talking about.
Yeah.
The opposition, you know, keeps calling on resignation, on change and whatnot, but has not come up with any particular informative strategies on what perhaps may be, be needed to combat this insecurity.
Now, when you ask me about insecurity, I've said this many times here in your presence. When there's a security lapse, when a ship with young students sank in Korea, the minister responsible for for that transportation has resigned.
Yeah.
When there's a massive train accident in some countries.
When there's just
the minister
a train accident.
In terms of transport, quit.
Well, quit.
It's an accident.
And takes so responsibility. Yeah, takes responsibility for it. This is the only country where you can get hundreds of Kenyans being lost,
you know,
and their lives. And here is out there some people in the government trying to justify that. Look, they've been doing enough. And the fact that there were these lapses is we have done much more than that, than what you've just seen. We're not in a state of war. It's not like the Second World War or the First War or the Arab-Israeli War. It's not a war as such. We have insecurity. And the people who are responsible for security here should take responsibility. And then you see the president and his deputy rush up very fast to come and defend the security machinery.
Yes.
You get my point.
They should
these are the guys who should say, yeah, no, my friend, you have to take a walk. You have to take a walk. Either I have to take a walk as the president or the deputy president. Or you take a walk because I can't defend this.
Yeah.
Now, that is not happening. We're back into the old...
Maybe there's a quiet acknowledgement that the information is shared between the executive and the security agencies. They all know what is there. So you can't come and blame me if we had told you, for example, we need 3,000 police patrolling the border and we have only 200. When they are overrun, you cannot come and say, you fire me. So it seems to me that the information that is required to fix the security is with the highest office in the land. It is that the office has not made provision for it.
But you are saying there's provision because there are helicopters. Gunships.
Look. We have this. We are not at war.
Yeah.
It's not that you need 200,000 men out there to fight because our country is invaded by a powerful neighbor.
Yeah.
These are a ragtag, a few, you know, crooks and bandits and
we have discussed like that. Bandits. Let us not repeat that again. Tell me about ODM.
So to deal with them, to deal.
I think you want to talk about ODM, and I think it's ODM. Polluting not our discussion.
Look. ODM is my party. Has up until now continued to be my party, and still is my party. I don't know. Nobody has shared with me what happened day before yesterday, including even the knowledge or the information on the retreat. And all the major ideologues of the party themselves were not also put in the know. The way I see it, this latest action is going to affect the party in a very big way.
Positively or negatively?
Seriously negatively.
Yes. Why so? According to the newspapers, the young and the old, everybody is happy, apparently.
Well, I don't think so myself, and I don't think that at all. The party, I think, with this latest move has lost both its heart and soul and its head. Because we thought the party stood for, although we have this constant business of parties changing names, but there was an ideological grouping that was there fighting together for change in this country for the last 25 years. And the feeling in most of them is that this party has now been given to the YK92s of the olden days, and it's been sold to the highest bidder. I think this is a question that a matter that is going to be up for discussion in many circles in the course of this.
What are you suggesting? That the people who got post
Look,
paid for it?
We have always had that problem of graft in the party, including the nominations. One of the reasons why the party has such a big problem is that all the YK92 guys did manage to get themselves tickets last time, and even before then. This problem of rumors of money changing hands in the party at the highest level and at high level up there for purposes of nominations and the rest of it has been there with us for quite a while. We've tried to mitigate that. We've tried to keep the ideological underpinnings very firm in there. And some of us have been fighting a losing battle for a very long time now. But I think now is more or less the defining moment. And I think we have a serious problem. I can tell you that. We have a serious, serious problem. And our friends, our adversaries in the political sphere here, which is Jubilee, must be laughing all the way to the bank now because of what has happened.
But what has Jubilee got to do with it? I mean,
Jubilee has everything to do with what happens in ODM.
Jubilee has nothing to do with it because
Raila
who has decided to make
That's why I'm telling you. That's what
the antagonists in the ODM have been brought together.
Yes.
So there's no, we expect there'll be no squabbling anymore.
If this, what has happened right now, takes a firm route, I can assure you there's nothing, no ODM party anymore. It's just going to turn out to become a very small party because it will have lost its heart and its soul and its object and its spirit. It's going to be, let's see where our friend will take it because many of us would not have anything to do with it and very little to do with it, with the structure the way it is. There's definitely going to be a serious fight to try and bring it back to its old ideological base. And if that doesn't work, then some of us, I'm not a career politician. I've been here as a convictional politician all my life, fighting for what I believed in. And I don't think under the new structure, what I believed in will be anywhere.
I don't see what you're meaning by ideological, because if Ababu Namwamba is the secretary,
and what is the background and the history of Ababu Namwamba, if I may ask you? I don't want to talk about Ababu Namwamba. I don't want to talk about anybody else who's in there.
But
find out right from his university days. Find out up to the moment, basically, what Ababu stands for in the committees that he chairs in here, and where Ababu's flip-flops in political position has been. An element of oratory in there, but you can be very deceptive and be a very good orator. Seen that a lot in the past in politics, but I don't know also what kind of a Raila person Raila is. I mean, Raila is in my opinion, probably somebody who has managed for a very long period of time to sell what probably he was not at heart, and I think that probably is going to be another defining moment. We all thought.
What do you mean? You sell what?
Well, I don't know.
History says that he at one time he joined Moi.
That's the point. Kanu. That's the point.
But I thought now he's distinctively very different person. With a
no. I think it's more or less like that kind of a collision again, because this new group here is going to work out a collision with Jubilee. There's no doubt about that. There's going to be a collision. You know, you remember these guys who are saying, we'll come in through the door, we'll come in through the window, and whatever happens, we have to be the government. And when this new lineup was announced, these are the guys who are celebrating. Look at the media. These are the guys who are celebrating. So Jubilee will have somebody who is prepared to be a junior partner with them in the management of the affairs of the state, who probably are dying to be in government, to run around with cars with flags. Many of us don't care about that. We just wanted to see if we can leave this country better than we found it in the first place through certain emancipation of the broad base of the Kenyan society, you know what I mean? The poor we've been talking about now and others. But then the jury is still out. I mean, you're asking me these things when we haven't exhaustively discussed it and come to a conclusion. The only thing I can tell you is a serious disappointment. I am disappointed myself. And everybody I've talked to who was a party stalwart and who was with us in the trenches for all those years. Where are these people when we were in the trenches in the 90s? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Well, they were nowhere to be seen. And for you to lose your heart and lose your the string that connects you to the genesis of your own creation, and basically look at these things only within the structure of power. One has to try and wield certain power. It's I think, very bad.
Are you suggesting that the opposition in parliament now will be a little bit weak?
Well, there's a serious disappointment within the mainstream opposition in the parliament. I mean, everybody I've talked to who are people who stood for something in parliament from ODM were thoroughly disappointed, extremely disappointed, and said they Raila has opted to give the hand over the power, the party, to people who are essentially wheeler dealers even in parliament now within the committees that they run. You know what I mean?
There have been
even by
member of parliament.
Corruption, yes.
The MP, they came out, not Joe.
Yeah.
He came and said, no, committees are corrupted.
Precisely.
And he gave an example of the Committee on Defense.
Yeah.
And how they investigate Westgate.
Yes.
That's public knowledge.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. So they say that these are essentially no more than wheeler dealers, and some of them who are supposed to be involved in very awful businesses that they have not come out. Fraudsters, people who conned their way into where they are now through fake
well,
things, and who have still not come out into the open to show that they actually. So it's essentially, these are the kind of things you avoid if you seriously are looking at that big politics in a country and the nation itself. Now, for Raila to make those kind of basic mistakes, there are those who say maybe there was the price was there.
So let's see. In your view, that Raila should have resisted accommodating them, because at one point, Raila, when he tried not to look like he was in support of them, he was criticized for being dictatorial, not allowing change and transition. And this team that has taken the lead in this, which was Joho and Namwamba, was the one that was, billed to be likely to take the Kasarani election. So now, if he has actually conferred the victory on them by acceding, shouldn't he be congratulated? or how should he be looked at? If he does not, then he is anti-change.
Look,
he allows it,
yes,
then he has sold the party to the
listen
other
to
kind
me.
Of catch
22. Listen to me.
So what should he do?
Somebody was talking to me
a
couple of weeks ago about a very successful and a very rich, I don't know whether success is right, but a very rich businessman associated to one of the guys who have now literally come out on top in the party, saying that we are taking over the party. And that taking over essentially was premised upon the changing of hands of
money,
material money.
Of course, the resources.
Just a moment. Just a moment.
Resources dictate
and
the politics.
We were,
there's no doubt about it.
And we were actually no. It can't happen.
A lot.
No. Listen, no. That's what we were saying.
Oh yeah, you are.
No. It can't happen. No. That's too open. I mean, why would Raila commit such a suicide? And that's exactly what has turned out now. For example, when he was going for this retreat. As a senior political friend, as I have of all this time, he did not invite me. He did not even tell me, inform me that there was this. Somebody like Junet Mohammed, who was there at his side, he told him not to come.
You
see what I mean? He told him not to come. Somebody like James Orengo, listen to me carefully. Uh-huh. Somebody like James Orengo, who is a stalwart of the party, was told not to come. He never actually came for the thing.
I guess it was between the contesting factions, which were called to harmonize. It was not any party organ.
Well, basically,
it was, I think, an attempt to reconcile the two factions which were contesting for leadership. And so he brought in. You were not in any of the lineups. Orengo was not in any of them. Junet was not in any of them. So I guess it was involved or interested in leadership. Come, we hammer out a harmonized leadership.
Listen to me. This is not buying a property where there are two contesting leaders and you say let's see whether they can strike a deal that you come out win. Just a moment, David. You say let's find when you have a point. What informed everything that happened is a position that was taken by the stalwarts like me and Orengo and Junet, who is young as he is but basically is very vocal, and many others and Gumbo and many others, Engineer Gumbo, all those guys were left out. They were not even invited, let me tell you. So the point is to say that we are going to bring these two factions together.
But Farah,
we were opposed. I was opposed myself to Ababu taking over. I was also opposed to Zani taking over. And I was saying, let's.
So now, who else were you supporting?
Just a moment.
Only
just
those who are in the rest.
Just a moment. David, let me explain to you.
Yes.
What I was saying is that let's go into a proper retreat. Let's have a proper soul searching. Let us see what kind of people we want to vest with the responsibility of running this political party. I personally had never fronted myself, or rather advanced my name for a position there. And I have my reasons for that. I'm too busy with other things right now, including going to school and business and the rest of it. I don't have the time to be on a full time in any position in the party. There were those who suggested at one time that I become the Secretary General, a substantial section of the party's rank and file. But I said, no, I don't want to take an active part in this. But he had the responsibility to sit down with us and tell us how do we take
see,
the party forward.
Farah, the problem I have with that, is that we are still talking about the favored few closer top, you know, party influential people. How about the ordinary rank and file who may not have proximity to the leader? Okay, one. Two, this seems to have been a reconciliatory meeting, bringing together the two factions in contest for leadership. Because the party is being said to be falling apart and so forth. And why is it falling apart? Because of the contestants who are interested in taking over the leadership. So he brings them together and leaves out all the others who are not interested in the leadership and says, look, you guys, what do you want? Can we have a lineup that is harmonized, that is reconciles all the factions? And then this lineup we're going to take to the party organs. So all of you stalwarts wait for the party organs to disapprove or approve of it. Isn't that a decent decision, if you ask?
Well, I will want to see how it comes out, how it turns out.
Yes.
And
it's tough, right?
I don't think it
you don't think it was the right thing to do.
It was not the right thing to do.
You'd have called a bigger forum.
You would have called a bigger forum. You would have consulted a few of us. Even if I'm not there in the consultation, I have no problem with that. Yeah. Even if you had to get very ethnic, he should have consulted the likes of James Orengo, Professor Okwango Oyugi, people who basically were there as giving the intellectual dimension to his own political relevance for a very long time and his contest for the presidency. But call a few of those people and tell them this, Larry Gumbe, you know what I mean, and ask them, where do we go? I mean, these are the kind of things we have. Jacoyo Midiwa did not even know about it. His own cousin, you know that. Who is
I'm sure he knew, but he was told
No.
Anyway,
even if he knows about
in
it.
In that party, to that extent,
incidentally,
to a retreat, and nobody in the
information I have right now is that, I don't know, he will tell us. But the information I have is that he's not a happy guy.
But
whatever it is,
okay.
Whatever it is, I was never for any of the factions. Of course, I was for people like. I have no problem with the four people like Otuoma, like Oparanya, people who are basically there, who had their soul and their heart in the party, and who are not multi-dealing, not double-dealing and triple-dealing. You know what I mean? Just the other day, we had when the current deputy president was the Minister for Agriculture, we had the maize issue there. Just take a look at the list of the people who had the maize issue and find out where some of these very prominent new lineup were. You know what I mean? And whether that relationship has still been maintained since then.
Are you suggesting that if there was wider consultation, those appointments are proper without an election?
No.
Because we are not elected.
No.
We wanted to do elections.
Look, the election.
The men in black.
The election was still going to be done. Still going to be done. And in my opinion, and I don't know. I think Raila must be one of the most disturbed people today, as we talk, me and you, because he's at the crossroads of a serious fallout with people who, for a long time, thought that with all his imperfections, I can tell you that, with all his imperfections, that he's still going to make a leader who could be guided and assisted and make a difference in this country. And today, the narrative is very different from that. Let's see how this thing unfolds.
Okay. All right, let's wait and see what happens. Farah Maalim, former Deputy Speaker of the National Assembly now, and ranking member of the ODM fraternity. We're looking at religion and terrorism, and then we've added on a little into the ODM thanks to Mutegi, ODM elections, not elections, but the new lineup that was crafted by the party leader and which was unveiled. It was in today's paper, so you can read and have your perspectives. I'm sure we'll have more discussion on the ODM, the election, and the new lineup in the coming days. Thank you for watching Power Breakfast.